Hey everybody, thanks for being here. This week we're in the Columbia River Gorge fishing Drano Lake first for summer run Chinook, and then we're going back to Drano for fall run Chinook. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf and this is Angler West Television. It's very early in the morning and we're on Drano Lake, part of the Columbia River, fishing for summer run Chinook. And according to the locator, we're in the right place.
It's the end of July and we are just getting ready to open up buoy 10 on August 1st, so we decided to come up here and give it a shake for some of these later summer Chinook up here at Drano Lake. And it's just now getting light. We got an early start. I don't know why there's nobody here, but we're marking a ton of fish and the bite's been pretty fair up here for the amount of boats, so I'm hoping we have a great day.
So up here at Drano Lake, most of what we catch in here this time of year are late running summer Chinook. The majority of the fish have already passed by here, but some of them pull in here to Drano and can provide good fishing. Down at buoy 10, those are fall run fish, both Chinook and Coho. It's a little bit different fishery. Up here they're not feeding anymore. Down there they're still feeding fairly ravenously, so the fishing can be hot if you have a good tide situation. Up here it's a matter of starting early. It's usually good for a few hours in the morning and then it dies when it gets too bright.
Drano Lake is traditionally known for a spring Chinook fishery and a fall Chinook fishery. There's not as much pressure this time of year and there's not as much, it's a lot more spread out with people. But there's still plenty of fish in here because they're pulling in here because it's a cooler estuary area from the white salmon here. So these fish will pull in here and cool off, and the summer Chinook, summer steelhead, all of them kind of congregate in here. So it can be pretty good on days.
Well, this one just got a bite with an anise flavored shrimp. Didn't stick, pulled the rod down pretty good. It was probably a decent fish, but that's the way it goes. Gonna rebait. These are the anise smelling shrimp that we're using now, and there's a couple different ways to hook these up. On that particular bite, I actually hooked the shrimp horizontally like this, straight through it. Sometimes we hook the shrimp vertically instead, but we bury it up and see what they're gonna bite. Okay, so our rig, we've got a two hook spinner rig tied on mono, size 3.5 cascade blade. It's got the Washington Coon Shrimp on it. Got a leader about 26 inches long, Pro-Troll Pro-Chip 11 chrome flasher bumper of 2 feet, 16 ounce lead.
Got it, Marty?
Still there.
Still there.
Native or hatch?
It's a keeper.
Sweet.
Good job, boys.
This is the spinner that we just landed that fish on, and it's a copper Mexican hat. And Jason's got these rigged up with these quick change clevis blades. So if the bite's on, say, an Armageddon or a Mexican hat, you can swap that blade out real fast just by, you know, simply just sliding it up and undoing it. You're back in the game.
There's several different quick change clevises out there. There's metal ones, there's plastic ones. I just generally use the plastic ones. They're easy to come by and they work great. It's nice to be able to take your blade off real quick if you need to and put a different blade back on if you want to change out. So
we just landed that fish. Compared to what we've been catching for the past week and a half or 2 weeks, it's much smaller fish than we've been getting. Small fish, but still a good fish, and it's missing its fin, so we get to put it in the box.
Welcome back to Drano Lake. I'm Justin Wolf. We're trolling spinners and coon shrimp for summer run Chinook and have our first fish in the boat that hit a Mexican hat pattern spinner.
It's a keeper.
Out here at Drano, there's a variety of colors that work quite well. This is this time of year with the warmer weather and warmer water, copper is always a good reliable source, and they come in a variety of different shades. This one's like a half orange with a blue dot. That's a gold blade. And then you got a copper one here in the same color configuration, just different color blade. Those are all very effective. Mexican hat is a standard. That one's been bit before. It's got teeth marks in it. But those are all really good patterns. And they're early in the morning too. Chartreuse with a green dot can be quite effective. Anything like that. Another very effective lure can be as a mini cut plug or a kokanee cut plug. Both of these can do quite well. Nice thing is you can load them up with tuna and a bunch of scents, and that always helps. This time of year, garlic is a really good bet, or salmon slammer, to put in your tuna. And that's proven to be quite deadly.
Okay. Right there.
Is he on there?
Yep.
Still got him?
Yep. This one is on a Mexican hat with a coon shrimp on it. Apparently they like the Washington coon shrimp today. This one feels like a little bigger fish. Hopefully it rings true. Good head shake. Ooh, that came out at the last minute.
It's a hatchery fish. Looks pretty good, so this one's gonna go in the box. Little healed off nub there. So this is another one, a little bit on the small side, but hey, it's a hatchery fish. It's in good shape, we'll take it. That one broke off just as we were putting it in the net. So this is a summer Chinook as opposed to a spring Chinook. This one's been in the Columbia for a while, but it's in great shape still. It's probably headed to the upper Columbia, possibly even Idaho. So these fish have a lot of fat stored up in them. They're really, really good eating fish.
Another one of those bad boys, huh? There's a lot of guys that spend a lot of time rigging these and wrapping the heads with miracle thread and all that, which is great to do. Your baits will hold up longer, but I'm switching them out a fair amount and they hold up just fine for what I'm doing. So basically is all I do is just go through the bend of the tail of the fit of the prawn and then just let it dangle and let that trailer hook dangle below it. As you can see, it worked just fine. So just quick, easy, back in the water. When we first started coming up here a couple weeks ago, the water temperature was running 65 to 66 degrees, and it has warmed up to 69.65. So it's, keep in mind though, it is a little cooler down when you get towards the bottom, obviously, but the surface temperature is still warmed up quite a bit. So that being said, the fish are gonna be a little more tricky to catch.
66.4, 60 degrees, 60 degrees down at the bottom. So it's much cooler down by the bottom. If the fish are going to be biting, that's probably where they're going to be.
Oh, he's there. Might be there.
This one's right below the surface, Jack.
And he's gone. He's gone.
Generally here in the lake, the wind can be a determining factor on trying to maintain speed. It's today it's just really light wind, so it's a little easier to keep on point with your speed, but what you're kind of aiming for here, it's pretty stagnant water and you always want your rod thumping correctly, but being there's no current, it's kind of easy to dictate. If you can keep it around 1.95 miles an hour, you're pretty golden. But it seems to be about the ideal speed.
Good eye, Jason. Yeah, don't watch your rod, you know, and it goes down and your buddy tells you, hey, you got a fish on. So I actually didn't screw it up and got a hook set on it. a big feeling. Big steelhead.
It's much later in the summer, and we're back at Drano Lake, this time for the first of the fall run Chinook, and instead of trolling, we'll be hoverfishing row, a very different technique.
So we're doing a quick little evening fishery here at the mouth of the White Salmon, which is Drano Lake. We're coming over here where the river channel is, the old river channel, because it's a lot cooler water temperatures. And most of the boats that are out here are kind of hovering in this one spot. This seems to be the particular area where they like to hang out. So we'll see if they're here tonight. Get on them.
So what we're trying to do tonight is catch up with our brights. They're coming up. You know, we fished for them here a few weeks back at Buoy 10, and now we're further up the Columbia River system. So you've got upriver brights in here. You have jack salmon in here. You have a tule salmon in here. And you have coho. So the wild coho have to go back. That's law. The tules, they're just not as good table fare, so we release those as well.
What are we most likely to catch?
A mixture of all of them.
Awesome.
We were here yesterday, and we caught a mix of everything. So, yeah, they're just, it's just a mixed bag of what we're gonna get. So the bite is usually about an hour before dark. It turns on pretty good. So we're here a little early, but we'll pre-fish it, get you all tuned in.
Sounds good.
Yeah,
I'm excited.
It should do well.
Awesome.
So what we're running is a 3-aught hook, and we're running some eggs. These are cured in Fuse Salmon Blend Cure, and I also add about a half a teaspoon of red badass bait dye to the whole container, and then shake it up. That gives them a nice vibrant color. And a little chunk of sand shrimp. Put the sand shrimp on first, and then put the eggs on the hook, get the egg loop. Go over top both. Just draw it all tight. So on this setup, I'm running 50 pound braid to a B&R sliding weight slider, B&R tackle, then just a dual lock snap to a 3-ounce cannonball and a little size 7 swivel. It's a 25 pound P-line CFX leader and a 3-aught Gamagatsu hook. So there's a lot of different ways to tie an egg loop. It's all pretty easy once you get the hang of it, but for hover fishing, I like to run about a 2.5 to 3 foot leader. So what I'll generally do is go about 3.5 feet. 3-aught Gamagatsu hooks here. And this is the way I do it. Go through the front eye, out the back, just enough to pinch the heel of the hook and leave all that exposed. And then what you do is you'll wrap about 8 or 9 times, and then I put that between my pinky and my ring finger. Go to the other end, go through the back out the front about an inch, and then I pinch it all. So get the whole thing and pinch everything like that. Then that exposes that back end, and then I get my left hand and I pinch that, and I slide down that other piece that I originally wrapped, and just continue wrapping that 6 or 7 times like that. Then pinch it between your pinky and your ring finger again, grab that, cinch it all up. It's a perfect egg loop.
So we're sitting here at 26.5 feet. We're in position, rods are deployed, and the key with this hover game is to hold your rod still fairly close to the surface of the water. Indication of a bite, which might be a tap or a tap tap, or you might just feel weight on the rod, set the hook.
That didn't take very long. Just dropped down and hooked up already.
That's a good sign. I like it when they pull. I like when they go zip, zip, zip. We've only been been fishing here for literally not even a minute and a half. Fish on, so I like this place. And the bite's not even started yet. So these are free fish as far as I'm concerned. Especially when they start going around the boat. That's usually a good sign.
Welcome back to Drano Lake. I'm Justin Wolf. We're battling the wind and bright Chinook that wasted no time in taking our bait.
Woohoo! 2 minutes, fish on.
What kind of fish is that?
This is an upriver bright. So this is one we're gonna balk and take home and eat.
That's beautiful.
Way to go, Jason.
Thank you.
Nice job. How do you know it's an upriver bright?
Oh, a lot of them up here, once they get this far from saltwater, if they're still maintaining their good chrome color, their inside of their meat will be, the integrity will be really good. It's usually a good indication. But the tulies are pretty obvious. They're dark in color and a little different configuration to them.
As soon as you feel it hit the bottom, stop it and bring it up 3 cranks.
Is there a certain way I should hold this that'll make it easier when I get a fish to...
Yeah, just put it under your forearm.
Like that
kind of, if you can. And then keep your rod tip lower to the water.
And, basically, when we're hover fishing, we just let the line down to the bottom. As soon as the lead hits, we crank up 2 or 3 cranks, depending on how deep we think we want to fish, but we're close to the bottom. And then we want the rod basically angled down towards the water. I like my rod tip 6 inches to a foot off the surface of the water. That way I'm in position to set the hook when I get a bite. Looks like a decent fish.
Yeah, see, this is how we get doubles.
Typical location for a hovered fish. Sometimes they swallow it, a lot of times they don't.
The drag's really light loose. It feels like. Oh, shit, there it is. Oh, wow, he's darting around. What do we have here?
Got you a nice little Chinook.
Awesome.
It's a hatchery fish too.
Ooh, perfect.
Thank you, Lord. May we have some more.
Awesome.
Good job.
Yay! Woo!
Oh, shoot.
Oh!
Oh!
Oh, he's still there. Shoot. It's a tough one. It's in. Oh, there it is.
Well, she just got her a tule. These are not the best table fares, so we're going to let it go, but they're still fun to pull on.
I'm trying to guide him.
Delicious.
I couldn't see it, but...
Yeah,
too. Oh, it's a pig. Woo!
No, I don't think so.
Club it.
Okay.
It's getting near the end of our time.
That'll cut redder than the other ones, I guarantee you. They were thinking it was a tule, but it's a summer fish that's been in here for a little bit. I guarantee you that one will cut redder than the rest of them.
Another hatchery fish.
Awesome. Lucy, come on. Oh, sturgeon. Caught a sturgeon.
Yeah, real low to the bottom. If you're hooking sturgeon, you're too close to the bottom. We normally hit bottom, we bring it up three cranks. But sometimes the bottom comes up and down and changes a bit. So that's why you want to change and check the depth at, you know, every 5 minutes or so, and just make sure you're three cranks off the bottom.
Hey, thanks for making the time to watch today's episode, and I hope it was time well spent. Now, if we can help you out with your own fishing, be sure to stop into the Angler West store in Woodland, Washington. And remember, without our sponsors, there is no show. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.